Of course, yeah, the first thing we'll be talking about today, of course, will be what is history? That's, of course, I think I asked you to look that up about what history was. I think Kieri just came up, I guess. Hey, make sure you have your mic and cam connected. Yeah, yeah, good. Anyway, so what is history? Well, history is like a study of the past. It could be a study of human civilizations, which is mostly what it is for our history class. So we're studying, you know, civilizations either from a long time ago or up to the present overall. And of course, it a lot of it has to do with like different origins. Like, you know, the study of culture is one of the big things you see a lot in history. Study of culture, art, the making of war, pretty much all kinds of study of language, customs. It can be pretty much anything you could think of can be part of history overall. But history can be pretty much anything that happened before this class. So you could, you know, stuff that happened yesterday, you know, you could say was history. So that's something you can think about too as well. History's been around a while. If you know much about history, it was started by the Greeks. The Greeks, you know, origins pretty much were the ones that did it overall. And the word history is a Greek word. It usually means to inquiry, I-N-Q-U-I-R-Y. And inquiry is a word that kind of means like to know or to seek information about the past. Some people say investigate the past maybe as well. And so the ancient Greeks were the first ones to really write down historical writings or prose writing on how to write history. Of course, one of the men that, you know, was the first to really write about history was Herodotus. Yeah, Herodotus. I got to remove, well, I guess it won't work, I guess. But I've got an image of Herodotus I can put up, which is right here, I think. But yeah, I think I've got him. We could take this out here. There he is, Herodotus. Just trying to put him in here for you. Okay, maybe I'm not in the stream. Is that, can you hear me now? Should be able to hear, maybe because I'm not in the stream. Maybe that's it. You can't hear me at all? You sure? That's crazy. You sure? Because I'm in the stream. Let me see if they're, we'll have to start this over again. Okay, you can now. Okay, maybe because I wasn't in the stream. Sorry about that. So I must have screwed up on that, on the sound. So we were talking about Herodotus. So he was the first historian overall, wrote the histories, or also called the history of the Persian Wars. Now, let me go ahead and move on to talk about also prehistory. They have prehistory as well. Now, prehistory is like history before written records overall. And prehistory is very vast overall. It goes back several thousand years is when it starts. Usually about 3000 BC is when prehistory starts, roughly. And then it goes back millions of years overall. And history itself, if you study about prehistory, a lot of it has to do with like a lot of the sciences. So in prehistory, they rely a lot on like geology, paleontology, anthropology, archaeology. And the word prehistory means, if you translate it, I guess, pre being before, so before history was would be the translation of it. So they got to rely a lot on scientific information, because once you go back, you know, beyond 3000 BC, there's like, you know, not much information out there about history. So it's very difficult. So pretty much, you know, prehistoric times, you know, is like the Stone Ages, and going back to the time of the dinosaurs is pretty much, you know, when it is. Now, prehistory is divided up into different historical periods. Of course, we'll first talk about the development of early humans. That's one thing I did want to talk about. I'll go ahead and talk about that first as a whole. So early humans developed first in Africa. That's where they first developed. If you wonder about Africa, why Africa? Well, Africa, of course, was an area which was very warm. It's close to the equator. And oftentimes that area of, you know, the world in Africa where humans started was called the cradle of humankind. So it's where humans first got started as a whole. And they think from there, from Africa, humans then spread out, and they spread to, you know, they went into Europe, then Asia, and then, of course, eventually to the Americas, which was more recent. So humans started there. And then early humans are often called, there's different names for it. They're usually called, I've got the term hominids being used, of course, as the term hominids. Well, they also say hominins or hominidae, I think is the term that they classify for early humans. This would be like all the primates, like humans, orangutans, gorilla, chimpanzees. They're usually included in those kinds of primates, basically. Of course, we're only talking about the ones that became like humans later and our ancestors. That's mostly what I'm going to talk about first. So we'll go ahead and first talk about, you know, the different examples of hominids that existed throughout the world at the time. I do have I think I've got a picture of, I think some, if you go to that slide I got on the next page, I think I had some examples down here of some of the different humans that existed. Of course, the one at the top is one of the earliest ones that's famous, you may have heard about. I'll try to spell it for you, but it's on the bottom. You can see it, which is Australopithecus. I'll put the name Lucy with it as well for you. But Australopithecus, of course, which is the one right here, is one of the oldest that was found. I believe it was found first in the 1970s by this paleontologist named Dr. Donald Johansson. Found it in northern Kenya, Australopithecus. And of course, if you know about the first one he found, I think it was dated to about 3.5 million years ago, this early human fossil. And they called it Lucy. The scientists that found it. And if you know about the story about that, they called it Lucy because of the fact that it, there's a Beatles song, you know, Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, that was playing at the time. And so they decided to call it Lucy. I don't know if they knew it was a female or male at first, but they did find out later that Lucy was a 12-year-old girl, basically, that was 3'6". Was about it. So it's like one of the first ones they found like that. They found other fossils. I think there's two versions. There's Australopithecus afarensis. There's also one called Africanus, which both were found in Africa. They think they used like some kind of primitive tools. I think they walked on all fours, as far as they know. And the one on the bottom, which you see right there, there's, of course, the one that came next that's famous is Homo habilis, which can mean, I think it means either handyman, or some people call him, the other name they call him is skilled man, handyman or skilled man, which is right here. And Homo habilis was found, if you want to know that one, it's found in the 1950s by this paleontologist named Lewis Leakey. Yeah, Lewis Leakey. And it was found in Tanzania, which is like in Eastern Africa, basically. Homo habilis, it was called skilled man because Lewis Leakey found him with like these primitive stone tools, which I think Leakey called them, I'll put the name up here, but he called them pebble choppers. I'll put that up there for you, pebble choppers. Pebble choppers were these primitive stone tools that they struck against other rocks to make, like, tools. And they used it to cut up meat, maybe used as a weapon possibly as well. And so Homo habilis became one of the first early humans that was more like later humans. It's got kind of like the skull looks more like regular humans. It's one of the first, you know, early humans that they really talk about with the name Homo genus. And I think the dating of a lot of the oldest fossils go back about 2 to 3 million years. So that's like one of the first used primitive tools, and that's why it's called, you know, handyman or skilled man. So then the other one they got is I'll put up here, of course, the most famous one I got there in the picture is Draconoboy. Homo erectus, you know, if you know about that one, Homo erectus became really the next human that you start seeing culturally, which they start finding that one in Asia and Europe. So Homo erectus, I think, was one of the first early humans to start leaving Africa, as far as they know. That one looks anatomically like a lot of, you know, humans later, as like the skull and the skeleton you can see. And that's one of the most complete skeletons they ever found of a Homo erectus. Homo erectus was actually first found in the 1800s. So it kind of goes back. It's been around a while. It's considered, Homo erectus was considered, it was like the first, I'll put it in here for the notes. It was the first major hunter-gatherer, like human. So one of the first that really hunt game a lot. And so he had to rely on using like stone tools. If you know much about Homo erectus, he was one of the first to use like the stone hand axe, fire, He also used what they call the throwing spear, which is sometimes called, if you know what the throwing spear is called, an addle-addle. You've heard that term being used. Addle-addle is a throwing spear. And a lot of the early, you know, primitive peoples, like in the Stone Age, used those a lot. Yeah, the stone hand axe was something they, of course, used a lot, you know, in a lot of ancient times. So overall, change the logo there. So we're talking about Homo erectus. What are some other things about Homo erectus? Yeah, Homo erectus is widespread, like all over the place. Like they have found some, like in China, they found they found one fossil called Peking Man. You may have heard of. Yeah, Peking Man was found about 1920. He's another Homo erectus skeleton, kind of like this one, but I think they mostly found the skull and some other bones as well. And they had another one. Sounds like something like you'd find at Starbucks or something like that. But they had one called Java Man. You ever heard of Java Man? Yeah, Java Man was this some kind of early Homo erectus skeleton remain that was found in the Java, which is out in the Pacific. So apparently some of these early humans were even spreading across, you know, into what is the Pacific, somehow using boats or whatever, or either boats or there must have been some kind of chain of land masses where they could walk, and they ended up there somehow. So Homo erectus, if you study about Homo erectus, pretty widespread, one of the first big dominant humans throughout the Earth. Pretty much by about 200 to 250,000 years ago, Homo erectus was pretty much, you know, the dominant human, at least up to that point, were early humans. All right, then they have like what they call Neanderthal Man, which I guess the full name they call Neanderthal Man is Homo Neanderthalensis. And Neanderthal Man, if you know about it, it's considered to be the what they call the first Homo sapien that you have that appears throughout the world. Homo sapiens are like our ancestors of humans that first appeared about 200,000 years ago. So these are like actually Homo sapien or replicas of skulls of Homo sapiens that appeared 200,000 years ago. Neanderthal Man was like Homo erectus. They were like both hunter-gatherers. So they, you know, hunted a lot of game and stuff, mostly in Europe and southwestern Asia was where Neanderthal Man mostly lived. And he's called Neanderthal Man because they found some of the early skeletal remains of that early human in a place called Neanderthal, Germany. I'll put it in here for you if you want. That's where they get the name from. So they named it after a location where they found the first, you know, skeletons and all that. That was found, I think, 1800s, I think. So the Neanderthal Man, they've kind of been known about Neanderthal Man for a while. Neanderthal Man is known for having one of the largest, like, craniums, like a skull, like one of the largest skulls, of course, of any human ever, like the largest brain, you know, also as well. I think the average brain size of a Neanderthal could be up to 1400 to 1600 cc's. I think it's cubic centimeters. So you can see that's a Neanderthal skull next to a modern human skull today. So much, much bigger. You can see also the jaw is much larger as well. And if you know about the Neanderthal humans, they were known for having heavy brow ridges across the above the eye sockets. I think their nose is a little different too, as well. They're barrel-chested too, very stocky. The men, maybe 5'6", may have been the average height of a male And so they were kind of, you know, stocky and brawn because they had to do a lot of big game hunting that they were known for. A lot of them lived in colder climates. That could have been the reason for the bigger brain, keep their body warm. Although some people think the skull, like the brow ridges, are different because earlier humans were had more testosterone overall. Now, Neanderthal men are around for a while. I think they're around till like, I want to say 30 to 50,000 years ago. But if you know what happened to Neanderthal humans, Neanderthals, as you know, went extinct eventually. And there's different theories about what happened to their culture. I think there's one theory I've heard where they were the clans they lived in were too small, and the interbreeding, I think, may have led to why they went extinct. And then, of course, the other thing they think, too, of course, is that over time, what happened was they were actually, there was, of course, later humans, you know, your modern humans came in. Like what they call, modern humans are usually called, the name they use is Homo sapiens. I didn't really explain what that means. Homo sapien or Homo sapiens sapiens means wise man. Wise man, or sometimes they say thinking man. The fact that these later humans had more cognitive abilities to think about what they were doing overall. So they think that could have played a role, maybe why later humans, took over and the Neanderthals went extinct. Some people think the Neanderthals maybe weren't as intelligent, and people still will sometimes say that. You're a Neanderthal, that kind of thing. So that's basically like, Neanderthal humans and what happened. And then you got the, later humans that come in. And you can see that skull on the bottom. I don't know if you see that or not. But that is like what they call a Cro-Magnon. Human skull that you're looking at there. And I'll put that on the screen for you. Cro-Magnon humans, they appear about 30 to 50,000 years ago. That's when they start coming in. Why are they called Cro-Magnon? It's because it's named after the Cro-Magnon cave. I'll put here. Which was in, I believe it was in France where they found it. I want to say, I don't know if I have the date of when it was found. 1800s is when they found a lot of the, I guess, early skulls of Cro-Magnon humans. And what happened over time, within, I think by the time you get down about 10 to 20,000 years ago, the Cro-Magnon type humans, or Homo sapiens, they start to take over the whole world. So they start spreading all over the place, from Africa to Europe to Asia. And then about 10 to 15,000 years ago, they think they may have started spreading into eventually the Americas, like into the New World. So it took them a while to do that, but eventually humans over time, eventually populate the whole entire world. So they all use stone tools. I'm going to, of course, get into like the Stone Age, and I'll talk about that. But they use different kinds of stone tools, like stone hand axe. It's typically the kind of tools they use, but they used arrowheads and other kinds of similar type of implements as well. But by the time, I'll get to it later, by the time we get down to the end of the we get down to the end of it, eventually they start using metals also as well. Now, let me see. We need to go ahead and move on also and talk about the other period, which is let me go up here, and I didn't get to talk about the cultural stages of human development. We need to get into that also as well. Yeah, they do break down. There's different periods. You have the Stone Ages, and also the Middle Ages. So those are the two main periods I'm really going to talk about overall. Yeah, Stone Age and Middle Ages. First, I will talk about the Stone Ages, of course, first, really called the Stone Age is what they usually call it. There's really only two main periods, which is like the Paleolithic Age and then the Neolithic Age. So you got these two periods, which are right here. And you can see the oldest one is called Paleolithic, which I'll translate that for you. But Paleolithic basically means in Greek, it means Old Stone Age. So you got the Paleolithic Age or Old Stone Age. These are names they started calling the cultural ages of the Stone Age back in the 1800s. I guess the big thing about the Old Stone Age that you need to know about is that early humans, as you can see there, were known for mostly a type of human culture that was hunter-gatherer. They had to rely a lot on, you know, hunter-gatherer type culture, because if you know much about that time period on the Earth, going back 2-3 million years ago, the Earth was like in an ice age at the time. And so early humans had to rely on like a nomadic lifestyle, going after game humans that were out there. Various game, mastodon, deer, whatever kind of, you know, game they were, I guess, trying to kill and eat. And then a lot of the women would gather food, whatever kind of wild plants that might be growing as well. So at the time, early humans, like men and women, had like various roles that they played. I don't think women hunted much, so it was mostly women that did that. That period of human culture lasts a long time. You can see it goes on for 2-3 thousand years that you have that kind of culture going on. So humans lived in like small clans, maybe 40 to 50 people. Most humans pretty much lived in Africa, Europe, and Asia. And then by the time you get down to the end of it, they believe sometime at the end of the Stone Age, you know, humans started to basically move into the Americas through some kind of land bridge that went across where the Bering Sea is. Now, they do have this transitional period. I don't know if you ever heard of this, but it's some historians or scientists think there's a what they call a Mesolithic Age, which Mesolithic means middle stone. So Middle Stone Age. And yeah, like it says up there, it's like a transitional period that occurs in history. During that time, what ends up happening is that humans begin a transition from hunting to what is farming. So they begin kind of, you know, starting to move towards, you know, farming and away from hunting. I think if you study about that time period of the Ice Age, if you know much about it, begins to end, which that started, if you look at, I guess, history itself, Ice Age probably ended about, it varies on the time period, but I think the last glacial period ended about 10 to 14,000 BC. So roughly 12 to 16,000 years ago, the glaciers, you know, and all that started receding and all that. And the Ice Age started going away. So that happened. And then they also talk about the Holocene Epoch. I don't know if you know much about that, but they divide a lot of the geology of the Earth into different epochs. The Holocene Epoch is like it's the current geological period of time that we're in, which started about 11,000 BC. And so they think roughly around that time, it's close to when the Paleolithic age starts to end and the Neolithic age starts coming in. So that's what that is, the Holocene epoch. So it's the current period we're in geologically with the Earth. Now, yeah, then you got the last period there. You got the Neolithic age that you've got, which you probably know what that one means. That means new stone age is what it means. So humans then went through this Neolithic period where, as you know, what happened, the big thing that happened during the Neolithic age is that farming and civilization began. So humans began to urbanize. They began to grow crops throughout the world. People became more civilized. They stopped, well, they probably still hunting, you know, and all that still, you know, off and on, but humans began to go away from doing that. And what caused that? They do think it was caused by like a warming up of the climate. The fact that the ice age ended, and so that allowed people to grow crops, like probably grain crops, mostly like barley and wheat, and that became the main type of food people ate, because back in ancient times people ate bread mostly. That was the main diet, probably beer. Yeah, bread and beer I think became the main thing people ate. And so you got the development of human culture starting to kind of come about. At that point, people start developing technologies using metals, pottery. They start having language. And so you have all these different new things that are starting to come in at that point. Some people call it a Neolithic revolution. What is the Neolithic revolution? Well, the Neolithic revolution is basically, a lot of people think it's agriculture. That's what it was, or what we call farming. So that's the key. The key thing, you know, is farming. So without that, you know, without farming, you know, we probably would be still hunting and gathering. You know, my uncle was a farmer. My uncle's family's farmer for years, growing soybeans and I think wheat. So it's in my family, you know, farming a lot, going back years. All right, then they have the so-called. I'm going to go ahead and talk about the. I didn't get to the Metal Ages. We need to talk about that, which you can pretty much divide the Metal Ages into three periods, which are copper, bronze, and also iron. So all three of those periods. Sometimes they call the Stone Age, Bronze Age, and Iron Age the three-age system. You may have heard that term being used before. We won't really use that here, but they do think there was a copper age. They think the copper age probably started, if you want the dates on it, they believe it went from 5 to about 3000 BC. So that's usually the time period of when, you know, the Copper Age was. They do have a nickname for it that some historians, I'll put it on the screen for you, but they do sometimes call it the Chalcolithic Age. I bet you never heard of that. Chalcolithic. Some scientists or historians sometimes call it the Copper Age, the Chalcolithic Age. It's like Greek. Chalco means copper, and then lithic or lithos means stone. So basically, you translate it, it means copper stone age. So for a while, you know, at the end of the stone age, the humans started, you know, playing around the copper and starting to make copper, you know, type tools, you know, smelting copper basically. So that was the first metal that humans really used, you know, was copper overall. And then after that, you had the Bronze Age. Using the Bronze Age goes from, I'll put the years, but it usually goes from 3000 to about 1200 BC. So you got where humans figured out how to make bronze. Does anybody know how you make bronze? I don't know if you know that or not. it's two metals, right? So anybody know what the two metals are? If you want to send me a message, I don't know if anybody knows it. No? I'll give you a hint. One, of course, is copper. So copper is the first ingredient, of course, that you use to make bronze. Does anybody know the other one? Nobody knows? Or you can just send me a message, somebody. So nobody knows that? Yeah, I'll type it in. But the other one, of course, is, of course, tin. So copper and tin. However, if you know much about bronze, bronze is mostly 80% copper. Yeah, Jason. Yeah, you're looking cool, and yeah, you're right. So yeah, that's correct. Correct. Copper, tin. But it's 80% copper, 20% tin. You know, probably looked it up maybe, but that's cool. But yeah, so they started messing around with bronze. They kept using bronze even when they had like iron and other stuff later that they had. But like Bronze Age, you know, we'll get to it later, but some of your great civilizations are like the Sumerians lived during the Bronze Age. Of course, the Egyptians, you know, lived during the Bronze Age. That's pretty much when the pyramids were all built. So they're using like stone and copper bronze tools to build all these, you know, types of like huge, you know, tombs and all that. Oh, and there's one more, of course, which is the Iron Age. Which Iron Age usually goes from about 1200 BC and it can go up to like 500 CE or AD. So either one you can use. So roughly a little over 3,000 years ago, they figured out iron, which if you know much about iron, they figured out that first from meteorites that had fallen from, you know, I guess from the sky. And they started making metal tools and weapons from that. And then they also found iron ore, also to make iron. And I'll get to it later, but one of the first groups that I think first started, you know, smelting iron was the Hittites. We were in Turkey, Hittite Empire used them. And after that, it spread all over the place. Everybody had iron pretty much by 500 CE, they think. Anybody know the greatest Iron Age civilization, though? They were around forever. And they were in Italy. Probably know them. Anybody know that one? Should know that one. That's easy. They got emperors like Augustus. Oh, everybody give me an answer on that one. But anyway, if y'all give me an answer, go ahead. But the Romans, of course. But anyway, but so that's the Middle Age. So you got the Stone Age and you got the Middle Ages that you've got. And then, of course, what's after that? They got the, the Middle Ages follows that after that. Yeah, Martha, yeah, right. The Romans, the Roman Empire and all that, of course. But yeah, they got the Middle Ages that follow. Middle Ages usually goes from, I guess, after the Roman Empire fell, and it goes up to like 1500 CE. Yeah, Jason, the Romans. But and then also, of course, the modern era and postmodern era we're in now. So from the period of like around the Columbus and the Renaissance, I guess up to like the Cold War period is kind of considered like contemporary times and post-contemporary times as a whole. So not exactly fancy names that they came up for all these different historical periods as a whole, but that's how they break down a lot of history of the cultural stages of human development. All right, I've got two more things we need to talk about left for today. I've got to also talk about on the next slide, which is the, I don't have it there, but I do need to talk about the, I think it's on the bottom, I thought, if I move it up. I don't think I've got there, but all the different Neolithic sites that exist. Which there's a bunch of those. I had some pictures of them. I could probably blow up maybe if you want to look at them real quick. But they have what they call these prehistoric sites. And I'll kind of talk about that. We're in the, not prehistoric, but they're actually called Neolithic sites. I'll give you like, there's like a bunch of them that were, of course, famous overall. The first one I'm going to talk about is, it's called, well, the oldest one they have overall is called Jericho, which I'll give you the actual Arab name for it also as well, which is called Tel es-Sultan. Tel es-Sultan. And I think I do have a picture of it. If I can show you, if you don't mind, I could bring it up real quick for you. Let me look and see if I can find it. It'll let me show it to you. Jericho. I haven't quite figured out how to do that. Put it in the background. Trying to work on this. That doesn't work. Still trying to figure out this. How this works. I guess because y'all are in the way, how that works. But I could also put it up here if you want. I think I've got it up there. But I could put it up there as well. Here's another one I've got. What just shows you kind of a picture in the background right up there. But a lot of these ancient sites like Jericho, go back to ancient times. And Jericho, of course, dates back to about, it kind of depends on the date, but usually 10,000 BC is about where it is. And Jericho, if you want to put a like location on where it is, it's located in what would be the West Bank, which the West Bank would be what they call Palestine. Which Palestine or West Bank is located what we call next to Israel. Israel, of course, it's in the Middle East. That one is probably the oldest overall, as far as they know, Jericho. And so Jericho might be 10 to 12,000 years old overall. It's believed to be originally a hunter-gatherer site. And so I think it was like 10 to 12,000 BC. And they don't think that many people live there. I think they say the largest settlement may have been about 2,000 to 3,000 inhabitants that may have lived there at one point. And then what they think happened is over time, maybe about 8,000 to 10,000 years ago, it began the transition towards what is basically a type of agricultural setting. So they began like growing crops nearby. Jericho was also known for having fortifications as well. These fortifications were pretty old. I know the one for Jericho probably dates back to, I want to say, 10,000 years ago. If you know about Jericho, it's mentioned in the Bible as a whole. And I could put it up there if you want to see the little city. And so it's one of the oldest overall, and it's called Tel es-Sultan. If you notice that name there, it's a kind of an Arabic name. That's what the Arabs call it in the West Bank in Palestine, and it means, in Arabic, it means Sultan's Hill, because they think a lot of these early human settlements were built up on what they call a tel, which is like an artificial hill. So that was considered one of the oldest ones that first developed as a whole. Then they have another one that was also famous as well, which I'll mention about which is called Göbekli Tepe, is located. That one's in modern Turkey, is where it's located. So you got Turkey. And I could put that one up there if you want as well. I guess I could put that a picture of that if you want. I don't have too many pictures of that. That's kind of a weird place, Göbekli Tepe. Göbekli Tepe is believed to be in where it's located, about southern Turkey near the Syrian border. It's about 10,000 BC, they think, is how far back it goes. So they do think that Göbekli Tepe, another Neolithic site, is also just as old as Jericho is as well. However, they don't think that it is a like a city. That's something a lot of people don't understand about Göbekli Tepe. They think it was actually used as a holy site of some type, believe it or not. And they believe that apparently they built some kind of large temple there that was constructed that had huge stone pillars that were built with it. And these pillars weighed as much as like 20 tons, which is like 40,000 pounds. Each one was 20 tons, which is crazy. They first found this site, Göbekli Tepe, in the 1960s. And the Turks gave it a nickname. Göbekli Tepe means apparently pot belly hill, is what the translation means. You know, in Turkish, they call it that because of the shape of the hill, the way it was. It's not a big area. It's about 20 acres, maybe a little bigger than that. They first started, you know, doing archaeological work there in the 1960s. So that's basically Göbekli Tepe, you know, that one right there. Then there's one more I'll give you too, that's also well known, which is also in Turkey as well. That one is, it's one that's called Katalhöyük. Yeah, Katalhöyük. And Katalhöyük was also found in the 1960s as well. I think I might have a logo I could put up there just for temporarily, right there. Katalhöyük. But Katalhöyük is located, it's actually more to what is also in southern Turkey. Both are in southern Turkey, both Katalhöyük and Göbekli Tepe, both found in the 1960s. It's one of the largest sites ever found. It's actually a city, like a mud brick type city that was found. And the Turks gave it a nickname. They called it Katalhöyük, which means in Turkish, it means fork mound. Katal meaning fork, and then Höyük meaning mound or hill. And like I said, it was built up on some kind of tell or hill, I guess, like some of these other places were. And one of the weird things about Katalhöyük, it's famous for its mud hut, mud huts that they have. So you kind of see in that picture, it just kind of shows you like a diagram up here of like the mud huts. What's weird about their mud brick huts they lived in, to get into them, they had to climb down into them. They put ladders down into them. They climbed down into them, and that's how they got into them. So it's kind of strange about that. So it's kind of an interesting culture, but a lot of you know, cultures later, like, you know, Jericho, Göbekli Tepe, Katalhöyük, a lot of other of these, you know, Neolithic sites, they use a lot of mud brick because there's a lack of stone. That's what a lot of people live in in the Middle East. A lot of people still do. We could find some place in the Middle East, they still have mud brick type houses, you know. So, all right, the last thing we need to talk about, of course, for today. Now open up for some questions. And I guess we can go, I don't know if we'll do the study guide today, but we can probably do that later. I could probably do the study guide later, but we'll do. But I need to talk about as well the four earliest civilizations, which of course the nickname that they call that is the River Valley civilizations that they have, the River Valley civilizations. And of course, these are really the oldest civilizations to start as a whole. And there's like four old ones, of course, that were there a long time ago. All of them were, of course, in the Bronze Age overall. And you've got, of course, you can see all the ones that are up there. Pretty much all the four, you know, that they have is Mesopotamia, which is also called Iraq, India, China, and, of course, Egypt. So those are your, in a nutshell, you know, that's the four River Valley civilizations that do exist as a whole. And, of course, they don't call them that, if you know that. The original names, they call it the Tigris-Euphrates River Valley civilizations. Later, they call it Mesopotamia, which is a name the Greeks called it, Iraq. And then, of course, India was really called the Indus Ganges River Valley civilizations. China was the Yellow River Valley civilization. And Egypt is the Nile River Valley civilization. So that's kind of the, you know, the obviously the real names that they called them, and then they had to shorten them later. But you can see from that that the one that's the oldest is, of course, you know, Mesopotamia. That's your oldest civilization as a whole, which that one can date back. It says 8,000 BC, but some people do date it back to like 10,000 BC, really. So you're looking at like 10, 12,000 years ago when some of the earliest civilizations started there. And usually we'll get to later the Sumerians probably next week. I'll talk about them. Sumerians were like really the first civilization that really got started overall. So those are all your old ones. You notice they have river valleys, like, you know, you can see here, Mesopotamia's got the Tigris-Euphrates, India's got the Indus, Ganges rivers, China's got the Yellow River, and then, of course, Egypt's got the Nile River. So all these different river valleys were important to early civilizations. And, of course, remember, like we talked about with the Neolithic period, it was all because of farming that humans were able to do this agriculture. So that's pretty much it for that. Of course, we can go ahead, if you want to go ahead and look at the study guide, of course, we can. I don't know if you want to do that now, or let's take some questions. Does anybody have any questions, of course, about the lecture so far that we've talked about in my stream? So anybody have any questions? I know we had technical difficulties at the beginning and all that. Do y'all want to study guide now, or we could do it? I guess we could do it later, but I could just go ahead and answer it real quick. It wouldn't take that long to go over it. If you have any questions, let me know. But I can go ahead and do it real quick if you want. So what is prehistory? Prehistory is, of course, the period before human civilizations got started, which dates back to about 3000 BC. So it's about that time period. What are some examples of early humans or hominids that developed in Africa, Eurasia, Americas, of course, later? I mentioned, of course, Australopithecus as an example. Homo habilis was another one. We talked about Homo erectus. We also talked about Neanderthal humans or Homo Neanderthal humans. And then you got your, which were Homo sapiens. And you got your Cro-Magnon humans that you have. Of course, I gave you examples of different hominid fossils that they had. You know, do know about those also as well. What two major cultural stages does man develop into up to around 500 CE, of course? That, of course, is the, you got the Stone Age, which is, subdivided. Then you got the Metal Ages that you got. Sub-periods, of course, are divided. Stone Age, remember, is divided into, it's easy to remember, just Paleo, Meso, Neo. So Paleolithic, Mesolithic, Neolithic, or obviously New Stone Age. Metal Ages, of course, copper, bronze, iron. Try to make sure you know the order of them, too, where they came in. I don't know if I care about the dates, about that. Like where they were and all that, but do you know the chronological order of them? What type of culture does man rely on? Of course, to survive during the Paleolithic Old Stone Age, hunting and gatherering. So he was a hunter gatherer, like the Homo erectus was, etc. So hunting and gathering. What type of climate declined during the Mesolithic period between the Old and New Stone Ages? The Ice Age began to end. So the Ice Age began receding at the end of the Stone Age. And then humans began starting to transgress from, basically from hunting to farming. It says, what current geological epoch began around 1100, 1200? Years ago, it's actually a little bit longer. It's actually a little longer than that. That should be BC, I think, is what it is actually, what it should be. That should be 13,000 years ago, I think, is what it is actually. But that's the Holocene epoch that we talked about. And a few more questions we got left, too. What was the Neolithic revolution that occurred during the New Stone Age? That was where humans began to moved to farming, agriculture. That led to the development of civilizations, urbanization, another culture. That's what led to the whole, early river valley civilizations like Egypt and in China and India and in Mesopotamia, the oldest. What are some Neolithic sites? Of course, we talked about their locations. I told you the oldest is Jericho, also called Tel es-Sultan, located in the West Bank, Palestine. That one's the oldest. I told you about Göbekli Tepe, located in Turkey. That's the one that's called Potbelly Hill. That's the one known as that for that holy site. That's really ancient. That probably as old as Jericho is, you think. But they don't think it's a city, like I said. And then, of course, you also have the last one I gave you was Katal Huyuk, also in southern Turkey as well. That's the one that meant fork mound, you remember? And that one, of course, not quite as old. I didn't give you the date on that one, but it's roughly, if you want to know, close to 10,000 years old. But that was the one I told you about that was known for having the mud brick huts that they lived in with the doors and the roof and all of that. And so those three are really the oldest, I think they believe, for Neolithic sites in the world. Then, of course, at the end, I already told you already at the end of my lecture, but remember the four river valley civilizations and their rivers. You've got Mesopotamia or Iraq, which is, of course, Tigris-Euphrates River. You've got India, the second oldest, of course, which has the Indus and Ganges rivers. You've got China with the Yellow River. And then you've got Egypt, which is got the Nile River in North Africa. So, Egypt, it's kind of funny about Egypt. But for a long time, up to the 1800s, everybody thought that Egypt was actually the oldest, for a long, long time. But from archaeology and stuff like that, they now know that Mesopotamia is actually older overall. So anyway, that pretty much is it for my lecture and review and the study guide. So does anybody have any questions? We're still here online. Sorry, we had technical difficulties at the beginning. I think what happened was I put myself out of the stream, and that's why you couldn't hear me. So anybody have any questions on YouTube, in StreamYard? Anybody want to unmute their mic if they have a question? So anybody have a question? So we got one coming up. Do you have to have the book report done, Michaela? I think in the first couple weeks, I do want you to just pick the title book you want. Just email me.
Yeah, that's what I meant. I'm sorry. I meant to say what book we want to choose. Yeah.
Yeah, just email it.
Okay.
What book title you want. You have to okay it and all that. Anybody else have a question about the lecture or two? Now, of course, later, don't forget, it's probably better if you comment through YouTube, because you know you get bonus points for that. So you don't get any bonus points for comments on here. I know that's kind of terrible, but so you have to, you know, send me comments, send me any feedback about my lecture, good or bad, I don't care. If you have any historical questions, you know, which is worth a little more bonus points, let me know about that. Before we go, a reminder again, send me your contract policy page. Don't forget about that overall. Also, email me, like I say, your book report, you know, title you want to do, you know, for the semester. Also, the pretest. I've been sending a lot of emails out about the pretest, but try to complete that. Like my shirt I got on. I'm wearing a t-shirt instead of the day. But anyway, try to get that done. I think August 21st, which is Friday, is the due date for when the pretest is due. If anybody wants to do that veterans project, let me know too. Okay, so that's it for this stream. I went longer because of the technical difficulties I had earlier, so we had to kind of start over. But that's it for today. I will have a 1 o'clock stream I'm going to have, but you don't have to be here for that. We do have some comments on the bottom that are coming in. Is that a comment I saw? Somebody had a comment about what kind of holy site it was, Göbekli Tepe. It was mostly used for, like, they think animal sacrifices, because they found like a lot of bones there, apparently. Like old bones, that's one thing. They found thousands of them. I don't know what it was, some kind of ritualistic thing or something, apparently, which they don't know much about what happened with that. It's Göbekli with an L in it. But what are some examples of some of the Metal Age tools they? Well, it's kind of like tools like we have now, you know, like iron type tools, you know. It could be anything they have now, metal tools, you know, hammer, whatever, chisel, you know. Obviously, the big thing they made with metal tools was like swords and spears, you'd use weapons. That's the big thing. So anyway, bronze swords, iron swords. But any other questions later, just let me know, you know, after the broadcast and all that. But yeah, 1 o'clock, I've got, you know, a broadcast. But you don't have to be here for that one. Let other students come in and participate for that. But it will be up. I'll put this up on YouTube for you. Okay? So that's it for the broadcast. Y'all take care. I'll see y'all next week. I'll probably have some kind of new announcement about next week, because I will be lecturing about Mesopotamia next week pretty much. That's it. Okay? So y'all take care. Have a good weekend coming up.